have another message for you, specifically the people of Masjid Furqan. I went to a number of countries. I went to as far as Kenya. Before that, I went to Australia. And then I went to recently, on Thursday, I came back from Turkey. And every single location I went to, people were telling me that
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين ولقد استهزئ برسل من قبلك فحاق بالذين سخروا منهم ما كانوا به يستهزئون قل سيروا في الأرض ثم انظروا كيف كان عاقبة المكذبين قل لمن ما في السماوات والأرض قل لله كتب على نفسه الرحمة ليجمعنكم إلى يوم القيامة لا ريب فيه الذين خسروا أنفسهم فهم لا يؤمنون وله ما سكن في الليل والنهار وهو السميع العليم قل أغير الله أتخذ وليا فاطر السماوات والأرض وهو يطعم ولا يطعم قل إني أمرت أن أكون أول من أسلم ولا تكونن من المشركين قل إني أخاف إن عصيت ربي عذاب يوم عظيم من يصرف عنه يومئذ فقد رحمه وذلك الفوز المبين وإن يمسسك الله بضر فلا كاشف له إلا هو وإن يمسسك بخير فهو على كل شيء قدير وهو القاهر فوق عباده وهو القاهر فوق عباده وهو الحكيم الخبير قل أي شيء أكبر شهادة قل الله شهيد بيني وبينكم وأوحي إلي هذا القرآن لأنذركم به ومن بلغ أئنكم لتشهدون أن مع الله آلهة أخرى قل لا أشهد قل إنما هو إله واحد وإنني بريء مما تشركون الذين آتيناهم الكتاب يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم الذين خسروا أنفسهم فهم لا يؤمنون ومن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا أو كذب بآياته إنه لا يفلح الظالمون ويوم نحشرهم جميعا ثم نقول للذين أشركوا أشركوا أين شركاؤكم ثم نقول للذين أشركوا أين شركاؤكم الذين كنتم تزعمون ثم لم تكن فتنتهم إلا أن قالوا والله ربنا ما كنا مشركين انظر كيف كذبوا على أنفسهم وضل عنهم ما كانوا يفترون ومنهم يستمع إليك وجعلنا على قلوبهم أكنة أن يفقهوه وفي آذانهم وقرا وإن يروا كل آية لا يؤمنوا بها حتى إذا جاء يقول الذين كفروا إن هذا إلا أساطير الأولين وهم ينهون عنه ويناون عنه وإن يهلكون إلا أنفسهم وما يشعرون ولو ترى إذ وقفوا على النار فقالوا يا ليتنا نرد ولا نكذب بآيات ربنا ونكون من المؤمنين بل بدا لهم ما كانوا يخفون من قبل ولو ردوا لعادوا لما نهوا عنه وإنهم لكاذبون وقالوا إن هي إلا حياتنا الدنيا وما نحن بمبعوثين ولو ترى إذ وقفوا على ربهم قال أليس هذا بالحق قالوا بلى وربنا قال فذوقوا العذاب بما كنتم تكفرون قد خسر الذين كذبوا بلقاء الله حتى إذا جاءتهم الساعة بغتة قالوا يا حسرتنا على ما فرطنا فيها وهم يحملون أوزارهم على ظهورهم ألا ساء ما يزرون وما الحياة الدنيا إلا لعب وللدار الآخرة خير للذين يتقون أفلا تعقلون
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقائدنا وقرة عيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين وأصحابه الغر الميامين أفضل الصلاة والتم والتسليم After praising Allah جل في علاه and sending salutations upon our messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم we proceed السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته First of all, I would like to say that I'm extremely glad to be here back in Manchester once again after a while. And whilst I've been gone from Manchester, the period that I've been away, I went to a number of places. And I have a few messages for you from those places that I visited. The most important place that I visited out of all the places I went to over the last few months, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala allowed me and honored me to allow to He allowed me to visit Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And I went to Palestine. And I have a message for you all from there, from the people of Palestine and people of Al-Quds, of Al-Aqsa. That message, it is that they said that you must convey a Yahya when you go back to your land where you came from. It is that the people of Palestine, they are saying that we want our Muslim brothers to come visit us. That's all we want. We want the Muslims to come to Al-Aqsa and to fill it up, to show the opposition that we want this land, and this land is the land of the Muslims and it's sacred to us, and that we are coming there to worship Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala no matter what. That's the message that they conveyed, that they want me to convey to you all. They said, we do not need wealth in Al-Quds. We are fine financially. We have everything that we need in terms of livelihood. But all we need is that our brothers and sisters, the Muslims, that they come to Al-Aqsa and that they pray in Al-Aqsa and they show solidarity with us and they show us that support. That's our message from Al-Aqsa to all of you. Exclusive message that I haven't mentioned anywhere else since I've come to the UK. It started in Manchester. And I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to allow us all to visit Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa whilst it is free. And perhaps for that as well. Ayyuha al-Ikhwa, we recite in the Salah, Surah Al-An'am. And I know that Sheikh Muhammad Ali started Surah Al-An'am yesterday, صح? He started Surah Al-An'am yesterday. I carried on from where Sheikh Muhammad Ali left off. Because these ayat that when I listened to the Fajr reflection from yesterday, because Sheikh Muhammad Ali told me you have to do it tomorrow. So I looked at where he is in the Quran. I saw that he's in Surah Al-An'am. And then these verses, the verse that he stopped at, these verses that I recited, I have a story with these verses. I have a personal experience with these verses that I'm going to share with you at the end. But before I share with you these verses and some of the benefits and reflections that we can take from them, I have another message for you, specifically the people of Masjid Al-Furqan. I went to a number of countries. I went to as far as Kenya. Before that, I went to Australia. And then I went to recently, on Thursday, I came back from Turkey. And every single location I went to, people were telling me that they follow your Fajr reflections. They were telling me that they follow the Fajr reflections and they benefit from it. Imagine. You are all sitting here with the ni'mah in Masjid Al-Furqan, benefiting from Sheikh Muhammad Ali, jazahullah khair. And there are others who wish that they could come here, that they could benefit from this great gathering that we have, to the extent that when I was in Kenya, every single day that I was there for the 2 weeks, I was going to a different masjid for Salat al-Fajr so that we do Fajr reflections. They said that we were inspired by Masjid Al-Furqan. Look at the ajr. That's reaching all those parts of the world. And what's even more interesting than that, it is that I met an individual who's non-Muslim. He's not Muslim. And he came to me and he said that I have been watching the Fajr reflections because they make the understand the Quran easier for me. Ajib, not Muslim. And when I met him, he became Muslim. One whole year, he said, I was following the Fajr reflections and he memorized a portion of the Quran just by following the Fajr reflections. Look at all the ajr. Look at the da'wah. Do not ever belittle the reward and the efforts that you are doing. It's great in the sight of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and these are efforts that Shaykh Muhammad Ali, jazahullah khair, he started. May Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala fit in his skills of good deeds. So these are all glad tidings that I have for you today. He says, I'm fresh and I've come back from all this traveling. Now let's come to the ayat that we recite in the Salah. Surah Al-An'am. And I'm aware that Sheikh Muhammad Ali, he gave you an introduction to the surah, and I'm not going to repeat it, but this surah is a surah that revealed in Mecca. And it talks about the oneness of Allah and the tawheed of Allah. and monotheism and worshipping Allah alone and being attached to Allah, and it refutes all the arguments of the mushrikeen and so on. The ayat that are recited, Allah says, وَلَقَدِ اسْتُهْزِئَ بِرُسُلٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ, that certainly messengers were mocked and ridiculed before you, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. What happened to these individuals who mocked the messengers and prophets? They were punished, they were destroyed. And this is a message to all those who may ridicule anything to do with the religion of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that whoever ridicules and mocks something to do with the religion of Allah azza wa jal, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will destroy that individual. It's a pattern that reoccurs, that occurs every time someone mocks and ridicules the religion of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, any aspect of it. And unfortunately, this is something that's become widespread today on the internet, that even Muslims are mocking aspects of the religion of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, making fun of it, poking fun at it, making jokes about it, and they do not realize how serious it is. They can take one out of the fold of Islam by mocking the religion of Allah azza wa jal. And then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ ثُمَّ انْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ. Travel the earth, roam the earth, and look at how the consequences were of those who denied and disbelieved. Take lessons from it. Now from the next verses onwards, this is where I have a personal experience with these verses. About 2 years ago, I think even the story I told Sheikh Muhammad Ali, that there was a group of us brothers, we were in a very difficult situation. And the situation that we were in, it would have led to severe consequences in this world. Consequences, severe, that could have ruined our lives. We were in extreme distress. We were in such distress to the extent that we all came together in the middle of the night before Fajr. And we're thinking of a solution. What should we do? We're stuck. We're thinking of anything. We're desperate. Anything we could do to get ourselves out of this difficult situation. We're sitting there the whole night. We're trying to call whoever we can call. We're trying to figure out any solution that we could. Nothing. We were stuck. One of the brothers who was present, he said, أيها الإخوة, I have a suggestion. We're in the last day of the night. Let's pray to Allah تبارك وتعالى قيام الليل. So we all got up and he told me to lead the salah. I said, I cannot lead the salah. I'm not in the right mind to lead the salah. I asked another brother who was amongst us to lead the salah. And subhanAllah, he started the prayer and he started from the beginning of Surah Al-An'am. Allah inspired him to recite this surah. And subhanAllah, as he was reciting the ayat of this surah, I've heard Surah Al-An'am many times before that. But wallahi, it felt like it was just revealed. I was hearing it for the first time. Especially when he got to the ayat. قُلْ لِمَنْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ قُلْ لِلَّهِ كَتَبَ عَلَى نَفْسِهَا الرَّحْمَةِ لَيَجْمَعَنَّكُمْ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Say, O Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, to whom everything in the heavens, the earth, who do they belong to? Allah, كَتَبَ عَلَى نَفْسِهَا الرَّحْمَةِ, Allah prescribed, decreed upon himself, made obligatory upon himself, الرَّحْمَةِ, mercy. I looked in every part of the Qur'an, I did not find anywhere else where Allah said that he just prescribed and made obligatory upon himself anything else except mercy. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala was, it is as if when I heard these ayat that I heard them for the first time, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is telling me about his great mercy. As if I didn't know about it, even though I know about it. كَتَبَ عَلَى نَفْسِهَا الرَّحْمَةِ لَيَجْمَعَنَّكُمْ, verily Allah is going to gather you on the day of judgment. There's no doubt in that. Reminding us of our destination, reminding us to fear that day. Those who are the true losers are those who don't believe. وَلَهُ مَا سَكَنَ فِي اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And to Allah belongs all that which is tranquil in the day and the night, in the night and day. And he is السَّمِيعُ, the all-hearing, the one who hears everything that you say, الْعَلِيمُ, the all-knowing. We went further down. The Imam kept reciting, وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. Wallahi, these ayat, when I was hearing them, it is as if he was telling me, Ya Yahya, this is what you need right now. When Allah afflicts you with hardship, there is no one who removes it except Him. Even the hardship, when I heard that ayah, even the hardship, I saw it as a blessing after I heard that. The hardship that we were in, that we perhaps would have faced severe consequences if it did not end, I saw it as a blessing. It changed completely. My whole point of view changed. Because that hardship that we were in, it led us to pray to Allah. That hardship that we were in, we went to sujood, and these ayat were telling us, call upon Allah with His mercy. Ask Allah. Show you how desperate you are to Allah Azza wa Jal, because that's exactly what Allah wants from you. So we did that, and now one may think, okay, is that where the story ends? No. Every one of us prayed for Salat al-Fajr after that. We went home. None of us slept. We got ready. We came. We met in an office, and we're thinking of a solution. Within around 8 hours, the whole problem was solved. Wallahi. And it was a situation that was so difficult, you will think it's impossible for it to be solved. Within 8 hours, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala solved the whole problem. We were out of the problem. It ended within 8 hours. And I believe it was no doubt due to that night, due to perhaps one of the brothers who made sincere supplication to Allah, and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala accepted it. Do not ever belittle that dua that you make to Allah, especially in the last day of the night. Now let's move forward in these ayat, because I have recited quite a bit, but there's another point that I want to point out in this surah. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He mentioned about the disbelievers. وَهُمْ يَنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ وَيَنْأَوْنَ عَنْهُ وَإِنْ يُهْلِكُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Allah said that they prohibit and prevent others from Him, i.e. from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. They protect Him, defend Him. وَيَنْأَوْنَ عَنْهُ, and they distance themselves from Him, i.e. the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. وَإِنْ يُهْلِكُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ, and they are not destroying except themselves, and they do not know it. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, one day he was praying by the Kaaba, and when he was praying by the Kaaba, Abu Jahl, he saw the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام praying, and he said to those who were with him, who is going to harm Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام? There was a man known as Abdullah ibn Zubara. He volunteered, and he gathered dirt and so on, and he threw it on the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام whilst he was in sujood. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام completed his salah. After he completed his salah, he went to his uncle Abu Talib. Abu Talib is a respected man amongst Quraysh. He's revered. And he's a son of the previous chief of Quraysh, Abdul Muttalib. He has a high position amongst them. Abu Talib loved the Prophet ﷺ more than his own sons. The Prophet ﷺ went to Abu Talib and he said, Ya Am, look what they've done to me. So then Abu Talib is enraged, becomes extremely angry. What does he do? He grabs his sword and he storms towards Darun Nadwa, where Quraysh are. And he enters, and as soon as he gets to the door, he says, Wallahi, not a single one of you shall stand except that I'll make them sit on my sword. No one stood. He said, who done this to my nephew? They all pointed at Abdullah ibn Zubara. Abu Talib covered him in dirt and feces, and he did the rest to all of them, and then he stormed out. As he did that, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala revealed this ayah to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to Abu Talib, Ya Am, laqad nazalat fika ayah. Allah revealed an ayah regarding you. He said, ha, what is it? Abu Talib said, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam recited this ayah to him, وَهُمْ يَنْهَوْنَ عَنْهُ وَيَنْأَوْنَ عَنْهُ وَإِنْ يُهْلِكُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ, that they prevent others from him, i.e. Abu Talib defends the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and he distances himself from him, i.e. he doesn't accept his religion, and he's not destroying except himself, and he does not know it. Abu Talib, when he heard this, he responded by saying lines of poetry, وَاللَّهِ لن يصلوا إليك بجمعهم حتى أوسد في التراب دفينا فاصدع بأمرك ما عليك غضاضة وأبشر بذاك وقر منك عيونا. ودعوتني وزعمت أنك ناصحي، ولقد صدقت وكنت قبل أمينا، وعرضت دينا قد علمت بأنه من خير أديان البرية دينا. لولا الملامة أو حذار مسبة لوجدتني سمحا بذاك يقينا. Whoever hears these lines, you think Abu Talib is about to embrace Islam. He says, I swear by Allah, they will not be able to harm you or come near you or Muhammad alayhi salatu salam, no matter how many they are in number. As long as I'm alive, no one shall harm you. Until I'm put in that ground, no one will come near you. I don't care how many they are in number. He said, advocate your religion, proclaim your religion. You have nothing to be ashamed of, and you're only going to see that which pleases you. He said, you have called me, O Muhammad alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam, to your religion. And you have told me that you are one who is sincere. And you are truthful, and you are always known as a trustworthy and the truthful one. And you have presented a religion. I know that it's the best religion of mankind. Then he says, if it wasn't for Quraysh shaming me or calling me names or insulting me, I would have accepted your religion. The only reason he didn't accept Islam is because of society, of what people are going to say about him. Now, this is the lesson that I want to point out to all of us. Abu Talib was with the Prophet ﷺ at all times. He heard the revelation come down. He heard the Quran. He was present every step of the way. And despite being amongst the Prophet ﷺ and the companions and being amongst the righteous, he did not benefit at all. Let that be a lesson to us that let us not be amongst those who accompany the righteous, who are in their presence, and we do not benefit at all. He ended up being amongst the people of the hellfire, despite all of that. Because he had layers that were stopping him from accepting it. When we as believers are amongst the righteous, we are in gatherings like this, it is not only our ears that are open, but our hearts should be open. The messages that we hear, we are meant to benefit from them. We're meant to take them away and implement them. Not be like Abu Talib, who sat in the gatherings, who heard the Quran, who heard the revelation, and it did not change anything in him. Let's not follow the example. We hear the Quran all the time. What effect does it have on us? Well, how does it change us? What's the effect, the change that I've seen in my life? These are the questions I need to ask myself. Because the next ayah is an example of how someone was influenced by the Quran, which we're going to end with. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَلَوْ تَرَىٰ إِذْ وُقِفُوا عَلَى النَّارِ فَقَالُوا يَا لَيْتَنَا نُرَدُّ وَلَا نُكَذِّبَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّنَا وَنَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. When you're going to see when they stood by the fire, the hellfire, and they're going to say, we wish that we could be taken back and that we do not deny the message and that we be amongst the believers. There was a man known as Ali ibn Fudayl ibn Iyad. Ali, his father was a great alim, Fudayl ibn Iyad. Fudayl, he would lead the prayer, and whenever he would lead the salah, he would look out for his son Ali. If his son Ali was present, he would recite something short because his son would be affected greatly by the Quran. He would cry a lot. He would be shaken by the Quran. But one day, Fudayl did not know that Ali was praying behind him. And he recited certain verses. And Ali cried and cried until he fell unconscious. And then his mother came after the salah and she said to his father, Fudayl, you are going to kill our son. And then another day, Fudayl led the prayer. And he did not know that Ali was praying behind him. And then he recited the surah, Suratul An'am. And he got to this ayah, وَلَوْ تَرَىٰ إِذْ وُقِفُوا عَلَى النَّارِ. When he got to that ayah, when you will see when they stood by the fire, Ali, he was shaken so much by the fear that struck his heart that he took his last breath and he died. That fear that he had by just hearing the verses of the Quran led him to die. Now, we're not saying the Quran should kill us or should be the reason that we die. But the point here is that these people, because they understood the speech of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and they had that great bond with the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal, they were affected by it greatly. That's a sign of Iman. That's when the Quran is recited and when the speech of Allah is recited or you're reminded of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that your heart is moved, that you're struck with fear, that it leads you to stop the evil that you're doing. It stops you from disobeying Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It pushes you, motivates you to do that to please Allah azza wa jal, and so on. That is the these are the messages that I wanted to share with you from Surah Al-An'am. And I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to benefit us with what we've heard and to make us from the people of the Quran, the elite people of Allah azza wa jal. And I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to forgive our sins. And I ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to have mercy upon us. And I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to guide us and to increase us in guidance and to guide others through us. And I ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. And I ask Allah to grant us taqwa and to accept our deeds and to grant us sincerity in our statements and actions. And I ask Allah Jalla fi'ula to protect us from the punishment of the hellfire. And just like he gathered us here this morning, that he gathers us in Jannah al-Firdaws al-A'la with our parents and our loved ones and all those who have rights upon us. Innahu lidhalika al-qadir alayh. Sallallahu sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Jazakum allah khair. Please listen attentively.
Barakallahu fiik. MashaAllah, MashaAllah, Jazakallahu khair al-jazaa. Shaykhana wa ustazana Yahya. What a blessing to have you. We have been looking forward to seeing you. And alhamdulillah, we are very, very grateful to you for accepting our invitation. Just shortly after you came back from a long trip, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. We love our ustaz, am I right? MashaAllah, we always keep you in our hearts, mashallah, so dearly. And we are also very grateful to hear from you the messages that you have delivered to us this morning from around the world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all your good deeds by traveling and going to different places in the world and also delivering the message of Islam wherever you go. We are very grateful, alhamdulillah, for those positive messages. And we are very grateful to all of our brothers and sisters who are benefiting from this small khair that we are doing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from all of us. Allahumma ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from all of us. And so inshallah ta'ala, we are alhamdulillah honored to have Ustaz Yahya with us today. And he's going to be, inshallah ta'ala, participating in our conference, the summer conference that we have today and tomorrow, inshallah ta'ala. The Ustaz, he's going to be here with us today. We want to thank him for coming. And he was traveling in the middle of the night just to make sure that he was here with us, alhamdulillah, to pray Salat al-Fajr with us and also give us this beautiful reminder at Fajr reflection. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him greatly. Say ameen. And we also want to thank very dearly, very sincerely, and mashallah, the brothers who came with Ustaz, mashallah, Ustaz Yahya, and who the brothers who have traveled with him all the way from London, and they brought him here, mashallah, to Masjid al-Furqan here in Manchester. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them. Say ameen. And I want you to come now, as usual, mashallah, and give, mashallah, your wonderful love to our Ustaz and also the Rufaqa'ahu as well, mashallah, the brothers who came with him as well. Jazakumullahu khairan. And we are very honored to hear that Fajr Reflection is going to different parts of the world, where the Ustaz was doing himself Fajr Reflection in Kenya, mashallah, where you went, alhamdulillah. It's good to see that. We're going to do a Fajr Reflection tour. Okay, yes, around the world. Yes, around the world. We have to do Fajr Reflection tour, inshallah ta'ala. So,
this has been documented.
The khalas, yeah. Fajr Reflection tour. Okay. Hayakum Allah wa biyakum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Come and show your love to the Sheikh, mashallah.